Welcome to this evening's events, to the 7th Annual Pecan Schaehrer Memorial Lecture, because this is the probably the most important of the events that we put together during the course of the Pecan calendar. There's going to be a little bit of formality that you're not used to during most of our events, but I think it'll become clear to you why we do this as you hear from us. Before I go ahead, though, let me suggest to you that you all mute your iPhone so that you don't suffer excruciating embarrassment at some point in the course of this evening's talking. And just as a brief announcement, I wanted to say that in the near future, you're going to be seeing or receiving announcements about information session for the Pecan major or minor, pre-registration for declared concentrators, and course offerings in Pecan for the next semester. So look out for that. It's going to be coming quite soon. Before we continue, I also want to express our thanks to Pecan Director Andy Rotter, to our new Administrative Assistant Edie McPherson, and to Professor Mundy for doing such a tremendous job in organizing this event, which requires a tremendous amount of coordination. So let's just give them a hand before we go ahead. This evening's speaker, Professor Paul Amar, is going to be introduced by Professor Mundy. But before that happens, what I want to do is to explain to you that it wouldn't be possible for Pecan to bring a scholar of the importance of Professor Amar to speak to the Colgate community without the remarkable generosity of a group of Colgate alumni who came together approximately almost 10 years ago now in conversation with us in the hope of advancing initiatives at Colgate that would appropriately commemorate the moral example of their friend, Peter Schaehrer. We in Pecan have worked very hard to try to advise them in fulfilling their aims because we share with them a commitment to thinking pragmatically about problems affecting the most vulnerable inhabitants of the planet. So we thought it appropriate to invite a representative of this group of alumni, Rick Stege, to give a few words of introduction about the group's efforts and about Pete Schaehrer. So please join me in welcoming Rick Stege, Colgate class of 1965.
Did you hear that, 65? That's 1965. All right. Good evening. Mark Twain said, if Jesus Christ were here today, the one thing he would not be is a Christian. I think he was thinking about of people like Kim Davis. Do you know who I'm talking about? People know who I'm talking about? All right, the Pope was here, and he met with Kim. Of course, we don't know what was said when they met privately. We really don't know, and we dare not speculate. And, the Pope is kind of behind the times on women's issues, particularly women in the church. But I personally was literally blown away by the Pope's presence here in this country, and particularly his presence in New York City. It was just something intensely engaging about it. It was a wow experience for me, like wow. And I'm talking about his humility, his obvious love for the poor and the marginalized in our society, and his insights into the evils of capitalism. Truly remarkable. Now, Pete Scheer is the guy whom we honor with this lecture series. If you were moved at all by the Pope's presence here in this country, you get just a glimpse of what was the essence of Pete Scheer. Without comparing the two individuals, there was just something in Pete that resonated when the Pope was here. Pete died of AIDS in the 80s. He was a quiet but bold advocate for civil rights, gay rights, and human rights. He practiced what he preached, except he really wasn't a preacher. He didn't preach at people. He just acted. Pete was our brother, and we very much miss him. Thank you.
So part of this whole framework is that now I'm going to introduce our distinguished colleague, Professor Jacob Mundy, in order to introduce our distinguished speaker, Professor Paul Amar. Jacob.
Okay. I have a bit of a script, but mainly I don't want to botch my details about Amar's biography because it's so dang extensive. How do you do so much? Okay, so here's what I'm thinking. In 2011, PBS Broadcasting issued a five-part series called Women, War, and Peace that was a very timely and very incisive collection of documentaries about what's going on in the world and how we might rethink issues of security through the lens of gender and sexuality. The last part of the series is a very interesting film that all of my Introduction to Peace and Conflict Studies students have been exposed to, which is called War Redefined. And in that film, War Redefined, they document the horrors of warfare that we've experienced since the end of the Cold War, particularly the disintegration of our ability to understand what is going on, that warfare is no longer formal, it's informal, it's no longer regular, it's irregular, it's guerrilla wars, insurgency, and terrorism, it's no longer political, it's genocidal. And in that context, a number of thinkers, practitioners, and experts advocated a solution to warfare, this new form of warfare that we've been experiencing. And that solution is human security. And human security is a notion that security should be, in a sense, democratized, that security should not be the domain of state leaders and war thugs and other elites, but that we should devolve the notion of security down to the lowest grassroots levels of society, particularly women and children, so as to prevent conflicts and manage post-conflict environments. The consensus that emerged in War Redefined from scholar Cynthia Enloe to then Secretary of State Hillary Clinton was that we needed human security. And human security has been essentially just that since it was dreamt up in the 1990s, an agenda that really hasn't gone anywhere. But what if we think about human security as emerging and taking shape in the world today? And what if it's emerging and taking shape in places not in Washington, D.C. think tanks, not at the UN in New York, not in London, not in Brussels, not in Geneva? What if it's taking place in other parts of the world? And what if the pioneers of human security are not the world's leading militaries, development agencies, or NGOs, but what if the pioneers of human security today are some of the world's most notorious police states? And what would it mean to understand and appreciate the new security regimes emerging in the global south, particularly as these countries emerge from the long nightmare of externally exposed neoliberalism? These are the provocative and groundbreaking questions Paul Amar asks in The Security Archipelago. And he answers them by exploring the ways in which gender and sexuality have become a central site of struggle in the constitution of these new regimes of security. He specifically explores the struggles in Cairo and Rio de Janeiro, and drawing upon extensive fieldwork in both locations. Now, currently, Paul Amar is an associate professor of global studies and international studies at the University of California, Santa Barbara. There he also holds appointments in, wait for it, feminist studies, Middle East studies, sociology, Latin American and Iberian studies. He obtained his PhD from New York University Department of Politics in 2003. This matters to me a lot, but under the directorship of Timothy Mitchell. Now, yet to describe Paul as an academic is to lose sight of the astonishing lives he's led before becoming an academic. Following undergraduate training at Duke, as well as the University of Paris and the French Institute of Political Studies, learning Arabic all along the way, Paul began studying in acting and cinema in Cairo. There he not only obtained fluency in Arabic, of which I am immensely jealous of, he also engaged in activism and journalism on a number of issues. Returning to New York to do his PhD work, Paul quickly, however, returned to Cairo and then expanded his fieldwork to Brazil, conducting much of the groundbreaking work that goes into the security archipelago. Now, given Paul's commitment to an astonishing array of disciplines, it should come with little surprise that Paul's research deploys a very broad and very interdisciplinary mixed method toolkit, ranging from deeply embedded ethnographic fieldwork among communities that are particularly marginalized in these new human security states, as well as using the tools of geopolitical analysis at a global level. Amar's research is particularly unique in the way it centers issues of gender and sexuality in fields of research that have traditionally viewed such queer topics as marginal or secondary in the study of global security. Not only has Paul successfully championed and deployed an ingenious method of socio-political analysis that focuses our attention on meso-level actors, that is, middle-level actors that are neither global forces nor individual agents, he deploys the applicability of queer theory to explain some of the most important trends happening in the world today. It is for these reasons and many others that Paul's monograph, The Security Archipelago, won the 2014 Charles Taylor Book Award from the American Political Science Association for being the best political science book that employs or develops interpretive methodologies and methods. In addition, Paul is the co-editor of Cairo Cosmopolitan with Diane Singerman, Dispatches from the Arab Spring with Vijay Prashad, Global South to the Rescue, New Racial Missions of Policing, and the Middle East and Brazil. Thus, you can understand, it was with great enthusiasm and unanimous consensus that the Peace and Conflict Studies faculty decided to invite Paul Amar to give the 2015 Peter C. Schaehrer Lecture. So please welcome me, join me in welcoming Paul Amar.
Wow, now I have to live up to that introduction. That's completely impossible. But thank you so much. That was very gracious. I hope you guys don't hate me after that. Damn, that guy's crazy. No, it was amazing. It was beautiful. And this is really an honor. This series of talks is very well known, and this endowment has helped to promote Colgate as a really unique and a model program for the study of peace and conflict, for the renewed interest across the country in looking at developing new methodologies for grappling with the current crises around conflict and proliferation of different kinds of warfare and social crisis in the world. So I think it's really an honor to be a part of this process of reinvigorating the field of conflict studies, of reimagining what it is to develop methodologies that promote peace on a normative and on a ethical level, as well as to develop rigorous social science methods that understand where conflict comes from and how social movements and activists and publicly engaged individuals like yourselves can make a difference. So this program is really important. And in global studies in UC Santa Barbara, I think we have a common philosophy. Our program also has a focus on conflict and peace, as well as on development and global social justice. So I feel at home here. And I want to thank, you know, again, Jacob and Aaron for doing the work of setting up on my visit. And I want to thank the trustees for endowing this series of lectures and for remembering a activist and a fellow traveler in this field. And so I really feel a kind of kinship already with this group of people. So yeah, and I've congratulate you guys, students here, for being a part of this major. Most of you, I think, are in this major. I think it's a really exciting experiment, and I know that in the University of California, we will pay attention to these things. We really like seeing these experiments succeed. So, yeah, let me plunge in a bit to my talk here. Introduction went through a lot of my journey in coming to this project. Just to underline a little bit more, I'm so glad that Professor Mundy introduced this notion of human security in the context of attempts to grapple with these new kinds of war and conflict that are not the army of one country coming to the trenches at the border of another country and confronting the army of that country. Instead, how do we talk about broader patterns of insecurity that sweep up other kinds, new forms of armed actors, new forms of ethnic cleansing movements that come out of the city streets and the villages and the social institutions of everyday life? How do we reframe the moral and the ethical questions of confronting new forms of civil violence, new forms of non-state violence, new forms of terrorism, and racially and ideologically motivated forms of violence? But in my work, how do we deal with that question without reverting to what I think is a dangerous formula of combining a humanitarian approach to this issue with a security industry deployment that takes up the flag of that humanitarian mission? This is the core problem that I'm grappling with in this book. And excuse me for being a little bit loose in my presentation. I prefer to, you know, just speak to you guys and look occasionally at my PowerPoint than to read, because I think I can kind of sometimes sense from you where I need to go rather than and adapt accordingly. So anyway, let's look at the bottom of this slide. You don't have to look at the slide if you don't want to. And sometimes, by the way, there'll be a lot of words and text on the slide. That's not for you guys to bother with or to copy down. That's, again, for my sake, since I'm not reading from a paper, I need to cue myself like cue cards on Saturday Night Live by looking at my own PowerPoint sometimes. But anyway, so my issue with this notion, human security was developed as we understand it in the field of international relations or in typical studies of this shift in the way we talk about conflict and war. Human security emerged, as Professor Mundy underlined, in the consciousness of Northern universities, in the consciousness of the United Nations, as an attempt to bring the people's needs in, particularly the needs of women, children, and eventually the needs of sexual minorities or the victims of sexual violence. Those were constantly the themes of how we're going to respond to new forms of war and new forms of civil conflict in a way that's both humanitarian, but which deals with these humanitarian issues, particularly women, children, and victims of sexual violence, or sexual minorities, meaning people whose orientations are to sexually define differently. We're going to deal with them not by redistributing control, not by allowing those people to actually occupy new state institutions, not by giving them land, money, resources, direct control over their lives. No, we're going to give them protection by the deployment of an armed force that's going to assert control over the sphere of life in which these women live, or which these victims of sexual violence are being assaulted, or where sexual minority populations are vulnerable. Instead of, again, solving this problem of sexual violence, of targeting of women, of targeting of minority populations through actual direct opening of doors towards to participation to those people, to actually distributing serious funds, money, control, land. Instead, we're going to deploy security operations which will envelop them and which will eventually become a force upon which they depend for their survival. So this, to us, has become a natural response. This idea that when we see violence against women, we see sexual forms of mass sexual violence in the context of war or ethnic cleansing or protests in Ferguson or in Cairo, that the problem of violence is more violence, but in the form of a rescue mission. that's going to counter violence with a protective form of violence. So this is what human security, although human security, if you read the textbooks on human security, will say, oh yes, but it's also about the social dimension, it's about educational dimension, about changing people's ideas. But in the end, the human security missions usually begin and almost always end with the deployment of some kind of military police mission that goes in to counter one violence with another violence, and to never actually give direct power, open the doors of participation, shift land, resources, and institutions into the hands of those women and of those racially and sexually targeted populations. They trade vulnerability to the bad guys and the thugs, and the terrorists, to vulnerability to a protective apparatus of an armed humanitarian intervention. And so that's why Syria today, we're going to be talking about Egypt and Brazil, but a lot of this resonates. Why is the debate in Syria and borders with Iraq and Kurdistan and Turkey narrowed to which armed force are going to deploy in order to counter which armed force? We no longer can talk about direct participation, direct redistribution of land and resources, institutional openness to different groups to share direct power, direct rule over their own direct needs, which was the original aim of the Syrian People's Uprising in 2011 and 12. That's no longer on the table. It's which intervention is going to counter which military intervention or to protect which population from this population. Off the table are all the questions of actual power and participation. So that's the peace side of peace and conflict studies, in my view. We always have to keep in mind that our goal in order to produce real peace is to enable real participation, real redistribution of access to resources and dignity and institutions, and that's where peace comes from. Peace doesn't come from another enforcement mission by military and police that counters one enforcement mission or one military action. So I just want to kind of present up that up front as kind of, in a sense, to expose my basic political agenda before I go into the deeper case studies, because all the case studies make sense, because I'm trying to, I spent 5 years at the United Nations in the early 90s, working in demilitarization in El Salvador after the Civil War, working in attempts to demilitarize the paramilitaries in Colombia that were killing indigenous people. My boss, Ingrid Washinawatok, an American indigenous leader that I was working with in Colombia, was assassinated by paramilitaries when I was working in Colombia. Then I went to work on the Oslo Peace Accords between Israel and Palestine. I literally wrote letters from Arafat to Rabin to Arafat. And then, of course, you know, Rabin eventually was assassinated after the signing of those accords. So I've been in the middle of some pretty intense negotiations over peace and conflict in my own life. And I saw the emergence of human security and, paradoxically, the centering of issues of gender and sexuality during these times of high stakes conflict resolution, high stakes demilitarization questions. And I, as someone who's involved in the feminist movement and as a gay movement and LGBT movement leader, was often put as a flag bearer of this new human security revolution that was gonna salvage the El Salvador peace process or paramilitary violence in Latin America, or that was going to make Middle East peace work, if we can make it sensitive to the needs of women, if we can make it sensitive to the needs of sexual minorities, if we can bring in. But then I became a police and military trainer in the mid-90s. When I went to Brazil for the first time, I was working as a police human rights trainer, this human security mission. So I'm in the middle of, I'm not just studying this, I'm part of this shift. And I thought, I was always feeling a bit uncomfortable about it, but I went along with it because I believe that, okay, these forms of violence, forms of sexual violence, forms of targeting of women, the needs of the gay liberation movement at a time of AIDS and extreme forms of violent homophobia in countries like the United States, as well as, of course, in Brazil and Egypt. So yeah, let's try this out. Let's finally get the police and the army on the side of feminists and of progressives and of LGBT rights. That was that temptation that I was faced with. My first job in Brazil was amazing when when a progressive governor accidentally came to power in Brazil. I'll talk about that in a few minutes. And I was in Brazil still as a grad student, and was brought into the committee in the security secretariat, you know, police headquarters in Rio de Janeiro. And I was supposed to teach the police in my brand new Portuguese how to be respectful of transsexual prostitutes and to stop assassinating them in mass, which the police have been doing for the last 20 years. So I was literally the human security expert who was going to change the mentalities of Brazilian police officers so that they would protect sex workers, transsexuals, gay men, women, instead of assassinate them or beat them or torture them in prison. So what I learned through that was, one, the police just would politely sit in class and then would go laugh outside the door and then go and round up my colleagues and beat them and kill them sometimes. So I've had some, you know, I've been in these experiments at the front lines and learned a lot from these experiences. And it's been, you know, it's been some tough research at times. But so I just wanted to kind of interject that. I feel that, and it's that when you, that my project, because when it, you know, when I committed to writing a doctoral dissertation on this, I integrated it into a, you know, more a critical, methodological, paradigm-shifting ambition to wake up forms of political science and political anthropology that I felt had kind of bought into this trend that I found so problematic. But I just wanted to remind everybody that this comes from a real commitment to these projects on the ground, and it comes from my own struggles with these projects on the ground. So, anyway, so I thought that was worth throwing out there. So let's plunge then, continue the story as it picks up in the book. So basically my internal critique as someone who was part of this human security revolution and realized that it was a dramatic sellout of the real goals of democratization and peacemaking. So I began, basically my core problem with this doctrine and how it was spreading, particularly how it was being taken up innovatively and pushed forward in Brazil and Egypt, where I began to work starting in the late 90s exclusively. I lived a total of 3.5 years in Brazil, 8 years in Egypt. So what I think I found essentially problematic about this new police and military focused role for rescuing, for shifting out of development of society and the grappling with issues of poverty and inequality, and a shift in the political agenda away from those questions as the most prominent models of state intervention, shift away from that towards military and police interventions which were going to solve the development problem primarily by rescuing populations that were morally, sexually, and racially targeted by other forms of social violence. So that shift from a more broad structural approach to development and equality and focusing instead on securitization, on a kind of security-based model of rescue and protection, for me left, raised a huge question in terms of what is the role of the state in relation to society, what are the goals for social equality and participation in a model in which we transform all questions of social polarization and inequality into questions of moral crisis, into questions in which we have populations targeted as morally questionable or morally vulnerable, who then must be protected by coercive operations that begin to operate more and more as a kind of missionary campaign. Missionaries in the human security model that rescue, that protect, that still are using coercive and, in the end, armed forces to do what development, to do what social transformation, education, and projects of redistribution used to do. So when I talk about sexuality in the book and I talk about gender, we're talking about this process of a kind of moralization of the role of the state and a kind of moralization of politics in general. Moralization, I mean, in this case, a very negative form of moralization. Moralization that shifts away from more pragmatic and practical issues of what are the origins of social inequality, what are the social origins of our forms of structural and institutional violence in our society, and instead shifts towards questions of moral crisis, constantly focusing on who is immoral, who is a pervert, who is morally degraded, who is either because of their racialized behavior or because of their sexual orientation or because of their gendered body and how it's presented in public, somehow threatens society, somehow threatens the stability and the dignity of society in general. So this becomes, instead of talking about the structures of social violence and inequality, we shift it into a targeting of immoral or perverse bodies in the public space. And then how do we solve that question of social crisis, which has been rephrased as a kind of moral, a set of questions of immorality and perversion? Well, through coercive human security responses. So this pattern of the state moving away from addressing questions of social inequality or inclusion or empowerment, is moving of the state away from even the discourse of citizenship and toward a discourse of rescue, moving away from the state dealing with social questions towards dealing with toward the state dealing with moral crises, basically a geography of immoral subjects, which will then target for protection and rescue, which is a kind of incarceration in the end. One has to become dependent on being rescued by police and military forces. That, this is a process I saw over the 90s and the 2000s accelerating in Brazil and in Egypt. And what was most worrying is I saw, just like for a moment myself, I bought into this, I saw progressive civil rights movements, human rights movements, and movements on the left beginning to buy into this formula. If we can phrase our constituents, our feminist movement leaders, our AIDS movement activists, our populations in the favelas of racialized poor people in the city, if we can phrase them as victims of cultural degradation or as people who are under moral threat from a thug population moving in on them or whose cultural integrity is being threatened by a kind of moral crisis in society, if we can moralize our problem, if we can phrase our condition as social movement actors as a moral question of crisis in terms of norms of society in general, then we can call upon the state to deploy a security force and therefore hope to leverage that security plea for some other resources, for some access to state power. So I started to see, even when President Lula, for example, was elected in Brazil in 2003 when I was there, and as we'll talk about in a few minutes, I saw that even the left and civil rights actors, the first thing they called upon was, although we've talked a lot about some of the small handouts and assistance programs that they offered in Brazil, what was most visible in the city was these massive missionary operations by security forces deployed throughout the city. So again, these patterns started to happen more and more of social and progressive movements starting to phrase themselves in terms of experiencing moral crisis and requiring moral rescue by human security operations led by police and military. And this became a kind of vicious cycle of dependence upon these forms of increasingly proliferating state violence and then taken up by private actors in the security sector, forms of private violence. So then as this book was concluded, as I was finishing writing this book, suddenly an era in which these contradictions, this increasing reliance upon calling upon the police and military to aid in both progressive as well as reactionary forms of political intervention exploded in a set of massive social movements and revolutionary type transformations in both Egypt and Brazil between 2011 and 2014. In Brazil, in 2011, we had what was called the pacification revolution. Has anybody heard of the pacification police units, the UPPs? Anyone heard about this? This was something constantly called a revolution in the time, 2011 to 2013, in which we had, again, progressive social movement actors associated with the left, deploying a new invasive policing force called the pacification police, in league with the Brazilian Navy, the same military forces, the same squadrons that have been in charge of the first enforcement operations during the military dictatorship of the 60s, had then later on been moved. There's the same squads and their descendants had been sent to Haiti to deploy humanitarian operations in Port-au-Prince in order to repress the population after the coup against the elected President Aristide. Brazil was actually sent in, the same squadrons were sent in of the Navy to repress the population supporting Aristide and Haiti. And then they came back in 2011, those same naval squadrons coming from Haiti were deployed in the favelas of Rio de Janeiro as this pacification revolution. Called upon this time not by the authoritarians, not even by the humanitarians like they were in Haiti, but now by progressive social movements, by movements trying to protect vulnerable racialized populations, and particularly women in these areas from the brutalities of other corrupt police forces and of the drug cartels that they can become enmeshed with. So we have this perfect example of now progressive forces calling upon literally the same squadrons that have led the military dictatorship, but been kind of cleansed of that identity by operating in Haiti during this kind of humanitarian intervention era, coming back, being summoned back home to participate with a new kind of police force to cleanse the favelas of this threat that was framed as a threat of public morality, of racial degradation, and of kind of sexual violence. So this is the moment in which the pacification revolution 2011 takes place in Brazil. We have the Navy come in, they basically are given a kind of blue baseball cap, which it signifies that these are peacekeepers, these are pacifying forces rather than invading forces. We have President Lula and then later President Dilma wearing these blue baseball caps coming in with the new pacification troops, again identifying this use of the military within the civilian context with these blue baseball caps as a new kind of down-to-earth civil form of human security intervention. So, and this was supported by massive waves of public support at the time. It did succeed in displacing the drug cartels and the military police, most corrupt battalions for a time. But what it did was, of course, it didn't solve the key racial and economic questions that had caused the marginalization of these communities in the first place. It just replaced the corrupt, brutal police squadrons with a combination of military being deployed illegally in the civilian context with a new form of pacification police, which by now, by 2015, has become just about as corrupt as the military police they displaced 3 years ago. Literally, just, you know, because they didn't change any of the inherent social contradictions. They didn't rout out the corrupt money launderers that work in the area and are connected with the landowners. They didn't rout out the profit-making temptations of the drug trade that is connected to every industry and every political party in Rio de Janeiro. They didn't face any of those questions. They replaced guys with one kind of hat with guys with another kind of hat, which worked for a couple of years, but now those contradictions have been ignored. And what's more dangerous is the pacification police and the missionary role have adopted a very radical right-wing Pentecostal ideology and have begun to advocate what's called the theology of prosperity, which is a very kind of right-wing, the opposite of liberation theology. It's a very right-wing theology that insists that poverty is the moral condition, is that poverty is caused by the immorality of the poor itself, and that one then has to aspire to change your own morality. It's not a moral framing. and that by disciplining and shifting your own moral behavior, you can become prosperous. So this has become, these pacification police have often merged into these kind of Pentecostal, paramilitary, highly fundamentalist, religious occupying forces that now control 40% of Rio de Janeiro. So we've had the kind of worst case scenario of what began as a human security mission to displace drug traffickers and to rescue racialized and sexualized populations from the violence of these thug and corrupt police forces, devolving into what began as a humanitarian intervention explicitly with the blue baseball caps that look like the United Nations has become the worst kind of missionary occupation by violent, exploitative, corrupt, narcotraffic-associated, Pentecostal, right-wing theologians. It's really a huge problem. It's now a crisis in Brazil. Egypt, again, this is kind of a peak, kind of when the dark side of these new human security innovations show their face. Again, something I participated in very deeply after living 8 years in Egypt. Many of my friends and students and colleagues, my human rights colleagues in the field, and social justice advocates and filmmakers, and were involved in the uprising in Tahrir Square in 2011. Do people remember still what happened in Tahrir Square in 2011? So how was Tahrir Square seen from over here? You guys freshmen yet? Or not even?
Yeah, it was seen as a tremendous victory for the people. I mean, it was a joyous experience.
Right.
We all clapped.
It was fantastic, right? And it was great because we're seeing young Arab populations that are creating a new kind of vision for democracy, that are participating with each other, men and women, Christian, Muslim, those that I don't identify on one side of one binary or the other, but working together, wanting to solve problems, protecting each other, right? Standing up against the violent police, standing up against the gangs and the thugs that were sent to beat them down, celebrating, being positive, having a new musical forms that they created, new kinds of songs, new kinds of prayers that Christians and Muslims would do together, new ways of women and men, of gender, staying together in the streets. How could they make sure, you know, women could sleep all night in these protests without experiencing violence or without being, you know, having their reputations threatened? You know, if you were there, it was amazing. They created a new universe of ways of participating with each other and of creating a vision for democracy. And it was incredibly inspiring, along with the Kasbah uprisings in Tunisia, along with the youth and children's movements in Yemen. Hundreds of thousands of children and very, very young people rising up in Yemen. It was an amazing moment. But the problem was that even these movements that were so inspiring and utopian and certainly didn't follow any of the stereotypes that we were used to seeing when we think about the Arab street or the uprisings amongst frustrated youth in the Middle East, which is often assumed to be a harbinger of coming terrorism and extremism. Instead, this was a harbinger of a kind of liberal or social liberal opening. But unfortunately, these movements had also become focused on, of course, the very real problem of the brutal police and the thugs associated with the police that were constantly trying to crush these uprisings. Remember on the 28th of January was the Battle of the Camel, when the few rich guys sent in camels and horses to stomp on young people and thugs to come in and drag women into the subway stations to rape them and beat them and to try to intimidate the protesters and get them to leave the square. So there were many days that were terrifying and brutal, but this coalition stuck together. At that point, the coalition began to include even the Muslim Brotherhood, included all spectrums of civil society. But the problem was, which is understandable, how to protect these movements from these kind of new forms of violence, from this massive forms of police corruption and brutality, and then the thugs who use specifically sexual forms of attack against women protesters in order to kind of kill that spirit of the revolution. And the talk was all about, well, you know, can we call on the military to step in and protect us from the police, right? There was a debate began, a debate that goes on today in some way in Egypt, and then how can the revolution survive if it doesn't have a coercive actor to rescue it when it's threatened by these thugs and these new forms of social violence, or by the corrupt police. It was a situation that reminded me so much of Brazil and its desperate need in the favelas and the poor neighborhoods. How do we save ourselves from these thugs and these corrupt police? Should we call upon the military? Is that really the only way we can, you know, and under those circumstances, it's understandable. And I, if you read my articles from the 25th of January, 2011, I'm weighing, right, the different ways in which the military can play some kind of role in preserving a notion of the state and a notion of access to political dignity in some way to counterbalance the horrors of the police and the sexual violence of these thugs. So this ideology was then picked up by the military. This is a famous poster. Interestingly, this is kind of a poster that went up soon after the military did intervene to save the people and the revolution from the voracious police and thugs. But of course, after that, the military didn't pull back, right? They allowed a series of elections, but then eventually took full control and haven't relinquished it since. This poster, interestingly, of all the posters of the young revolutionaries of the left, or the young rural peasant revolutionaries in 2011, and then we had the era of the Salafists and the Muslim Brotherhood coming into the parliament, and we had their posters, and then we had the counter posters. But the only posters that went through all these eras of revolution and counter-revolution and reaction were these posters of this one soldier holding this very large, plump, white baby that he looks like he's about to eat. And it says, you know, the army and the people are one hand, meaning the army and the people are hand in hand, right? So this is the slogan that kind of has survived from the first day of the uprising in 2011 until today. And it's kind of the doctrine of human security, right? You know, security and the people's needs are the same thing. And in the end, that's the military doctrine, right? So that, in the end, won the revolution, and that has won, in a sense, over the civil society dreams in Brazil of that would bring a social democratic state to bear, and it hopefully was the aim was to erase the military dictatorship legacies and to counter the force of police brutality and corruption that are so damaging to daily life in Brazil, and of course in Egypt, also this doctrine of the people and the military are hand in hand, or are people, in a sense, the expression kind of implies that people are both dependent and loving of the military, right? It's like, you know, instead of that man eating the baby, it's more like, you know, the baby holding the hand of a very wonderful father figure, right? So that's kind of, in a sense, the dark potential of a kind of human security doctrine, right? That we become dependent upon securitization, meaning we become dependent upon security actors, in the end, who are police and military, as the only way to solve serious social problems. So what I'm, of course, this book then goes into detail case by case. The fun part about this book is that each chapter, each case, shows how we in the social movements became aware of the problems of this bargain, of the problems of these bargains with security actors, and how in each chapter these social movements then realize the problems, untangle those alliances with the security actors and produce a new vision for participation, for equality, and for change that is not dependent upon security actors or securitization of our ideas, meaning that we are changing our whole ideas of the political to be framed by the notion of fear, rescue, protection, and dependence on security actors. So each of these chapters is about becoming conscious of that bargain and its problems, learning from it, and then moving boldly towards a new frame in which the bargain between social movements and security actors is broken, and a new alliance is made between various social movements that can imagine a different kind of politics. So of course, all my extraneous commenting, I've hardly begun my slides, so we're not going to get through these case studies in too great a detail. Do I talk for like 15 more minutes or something? What should we say? I want to get into some of these case studies, right? I think it was, considering, since you guys are peace and conflict specialists, I wanted to get a lot more of that, my own personal kind of passion about this contradiction. But let me just, so what we've talked about so far, we've gone through this process here. During this period, as we mentioned in terms of Brazil and Egypt, there was, in the 1960s, Brazil and Egypt were both military dictatorships. Very different sorts of military dictatorships. Egypt, a nationalist, socialist, progressive-oriented, anti-capitalist to some degree, third-world-leaning military dictatorship, which then, by the 70s, had become military in order to shift them out of power. Even their Nasser, who was a military colonel, he wanted the military out of power because he didn't trust their massive institutional might. It's too much of a threat to the presidency, too much of a threat to the state itself. So what Nasser did and what Sadat completed was to move the military out of the role of a governing coercive force and into the role of two things: humanitarian intervention in other countries and development of infrastructure and new cities within Egypt. So this was meant to move the military out of power, but what it actually did was position the military perfectly to grow and grow wealthy and grow prestigious in the new globalizing world. So the Egyptian military started to do humanitarian interventions in the Sudan, in Indonesia, in Angola, and although we don't talk about it very much, the Egyptian military thinks of itself, it was its humanitarian missions that saved Sarajevo from the Serbian militias during the Yugoslav War. It was the Egyptian military wearing the UN berets. I don't know if that was actually a significant operation in international relations. No one talks about it, but in Egypt they constantly talk about the Egyptian blue berets saving Sarajevo from the Serbian attacks. So that kind of age of the dawn of humanitarian intervention, Egypt's army very much identifies itself as having gone out in the world and cleaned its hands. While at home, it started to make deals with capitalists from Saudi Arabia, the very tip of the pyramid of wealth in Egypt, new Kuwaiti money, new oil money coming in, and the Egyptian army began to build the highways, the gated cities, the tourist developments, the shopping malls. The new Egypt of the upper middle class is the Egypt built by a partnership between this civilianized military and Saudi capital. You leave the old Cairo that I know and love so well to the Cairo post-1990s of the shopping malls, gated cities, the tourist developments, the new second Suez Canal that General Sisi is building in Egypt. These are all partnerships built by the military who can then appropriate those profits in collaboration mostly with Saudi and Kuwaiti capital. So this is a very interesting process of civilianization. This is kind of that economic dimensions of what I talked about previously as a kind of political moral dilemma. In Brazil, actually, some very similar things happened during the same period. In an attempt to get the military out of power, Brazil was a military dictatorship from 1964 to 1985. Actually, now that I think about it, remarkably similar to Egypt during its first years, this military dictatorship was actually rather social progressive in some ways. You wouldn't believe it if you were one of the student leaders being tortured at the time by the military. But the military was actually kind of building industries, kicking out American capital, developing local industries. It was supporting Palestinian actions abroad. And then in the later period, it became much more right-wing or neoliberal. It began to promote alliances between foreign capital and narcotraffic in Rio. For instance, the carnival, the great carnival of Rio, the Mardi Gras, the greatest Mardi Gras in the world, was privatized, used to be controlled by the state, it was privatized directly in the hands, literally of an alliance between a couple foreign investors and the local narcotraffic cartels in the western parts of Rio de Janeiro. And everybody kind of knew that. And that was kind of a model for like how these transformations, the military getting involved in making huge mega profits from these new kind of alliances between foreign investors and the explosion of narcotraffic, which it wasn't an underground economy. It was a way, basically, of money laundering amongst these new elites, these civilianized military elites and the re-emergent landowning classes in the big cities. So anyway, so you have the military moving into these civilian operations. Now, different from Egypt in that the military never, Egypt, the military started to directly, the generals started to take the profits they were making from these infrastructure projects and put it in their pockets. So you have an emergence of a few generals as individuals that are incredibly powerful. And they start to act more like sheikhs or like Saudi princes. That's why the world today of the Middle East is these Egyptian generals and the Saudi and Kuwaiti royalty all kind of getting along very well and doing rather awful things. But anyway, so in Brazil, generals never were able to pocket profits as individuals, but they became kind of these huge engineering contractor companies. And they were sent off, whereas Egyptian generals were sent off to develop the deserts and the coastlines, Brazilian generals were sent off to develop the Amazon. They were sent off to build highways in the Amazon, to develop the biotech exploitation industries in the Amazon. And of course that led to some disastrous social and environmental consequences. And just like in Egypt, the Brazilian military, again as I talked about, the same squadrons that were at the forefront of enforcing the dictatorship were kind of like exported to Haiti, Angola. They were also responsible for pacification of Timor and mediating the negotiation of the East Timor independence process. So these humanitarian operations, if we think of as implemented by the global community, were specific interventions led and driven by domestic political crises and conflicts within Egypt and Brazil. The way that Timor was resolved, the way that Haiti was occupied after Aristide's coup, the way that Sarajevo was protected during these wars, was a direct connection not just to international normative and regulatory frameworks around humanitarianism, but connected to what's going on in these two countries trying to get rid of their militaries, but making bargains with them which would make those militaries even stronger. They make them into very powerful development economic actors, and they would redeem them of their sins. Those religious moral metaphors are really important, actually. So when they come back as humanitarians, as rescuers, and eventually as missionaries in their own country, they're richer, they're more powerful, they're more legitimate. But now as human security rescuers, the army and the people is one hand. So
when these militaries began to re-enter the civilian sphere, again, this is thought of in our international relations studies as kind of part of a West-driven new set of humanized or humanitarianized modes of security. But again, by putting it into this context of the conflicts within countries like Egypt and Brazil, these, what's thought of as Western or New York and Norway, kind of centered interventions in the 1990s, looks very different. Now that we know that the people acting behind the scenes are these former forces of dictatorship, are these now new forms of military leaders that are enriching themselves, these different forms of humanitarian interventions start to look very different. These are the different kind of cousins to the human security intervention that emerged in the same time in the late 1990s. The idea of the pacification revolution of humanitarian peace enforcement emerges during this period. The idea that humanitarian intervention is not just when the hurricane comes or when ethnic cleansers are running through the village killing people, but it's actually going to enforce peace. It's going to move in and occupy that marginalized place and rule it as a permanent kind of police force. The idea of peace enforcement becomes a kind of a permanent policing method rather than a temporary intervention. And this flows into new ideas about understanding community policing, intelligence-led policing. These military doctrines, these intervention doctrines, tend to kind of cross-fertilize each other and produce a kind of web of different kinds of interventions. So now let's try to talk about one or two of these cases so we can at least get a flavor, a little bit of these. So let's talk, first of all, let's talk real quick about one more case in Rio de Janeiro. And then I'll talk about one case in Cairo. So each of these chapters that focus on the cases begins with a moment of successful democratic mobilization of social movements against these forms of police violence. In this case, we have a very strong movement combining anti-racist movements amongst the black civil rights movement in Rio, aligning themselves with workers' movements that want to promote the workers' rights of sex workers, prostitutes, but as workers who need protection from workplace violence, aligning themselves with the gay and lesbian movement that is trying to stop police and public violence against gay and lesbian people, often in the same areas where violence against prostitutes and violence against workers coming down from favelas that are racialized and targeted by the same social actors. So we have experience of public violence that are now being produced, a coalition that successfully took over the security ministry in this time, in 2003. We're bringing key leaders of military police to trial for corruption and for violence and for extermination of minorities. And even to this point, we had the governor of Rio de Janeiro going on trial for arms trafficking, for being allied with the corrupt police and with some of the arms and narco-traffic interests that had been connected with them. So this was a time of triumph of these progressive forces that allied together, starting with this interest in stopping violence in these public spaces, but had really produced a totally transformative set of accountability mechanisms and a new politics based upon workers' rights, upon public safety, and upon accountability for the police and for their public actions. But then in 2003, we had this human security bargain offered in place of this new coalition of resistance actors. The police allied themselves with new evangelical political parties in Rio and offered, instead of punishing the police and punishing the governor, they said, well, instead what we need to do is give the police a new moral mission that will redeem them and that along, and then in the process will redeem Brazilian society at the same time. So this operation that was going to create a new redeemed police force and redeem the sins of a kind of corrupt and over-sexualized and stereotypically kind of sexually corrupted Brazilian society, this operation was going to be called Operation Princess. It was going to be a process by which the police were going to be given a new moral mission to protect women that were trafficked into sex slavery and to protect children and young and youth from the favelas, from the violence and exploitation of organized crime and of police corruption itself. So Operation Princess was, it sounds like a kind of like a, almost kind of ridiculous, but was this idea, again, of the police and the people of one hand, in this case, of the police treating the people as princesses that need to be protected and have their moral constitution restored, have their kind of virginity and their reputation restored, rather than having them having women and social movement actors allowed into the state to investigate the police, to hold police accountable, to replace the police with their own vision of workers' security and social stability. Instead, the police were going to actually be increased and intensified in their deployments in these vulnerable areas, but now the police were going to be moral security specialists. They were going to be out there to hunt down and find underage prostitutes and hunt down and find vulnerable people who would then be protected, meaning to be, they'd be picked up in order to be brought to rehabilitation facilities where they could be have access to education and jobs, but basically they would be incarcerated to protect themselves from these vulnerable spaces. So this operation, again, a classic human security operation, defined itself in terms of protecting women from violence, in terms of rescuing children from sex slavery, in terms of rescuing racialized minorities from targeting. But it allowed the police to give them to restore, to absolve themselves of the previous sins, and to actually increase and intensify their role in civil society. So what I talk about in this chapter on Operation Princess is the way that these civil society actors, the workers' rights movements, the LGBT rights movements, the anti-racist movements, and the sex workers' movements, immediately figured out that this bargain was going to put them push them farther back and actually marginalize them from the civil sphere. And so I talk about the different ways that then Operation Princess was exposed and how the links between the police and eventually their videos were shot and police connections with traffickers were exposed. So eventually this model of Operation Princess was shattered by the activists, and a new empowerment agenda was articulated. Now, with the Olympics and the World Cup in the last past years, unfortunately, Operation Princess has come back with a vengeance. Now, with the international spotlight in Rio de Janeiro, it's become easier and more urgent for these actors to deploy a security response and this kind of rescue response in order to protect either international visitors or vulnerable local populations. So we've had, unfortunately, Operation Princess has come back after it was defeated in 2003 by the social movement actors. So, but it's constantly, just this week was in a big email exchange with activists in Rio who were, reading Operation Princess as like a strategy manual, this chapter saying like, we need to make sure that we shoot a video of this here and we undermine this discourse of the moral legitimacy of the police in this way, and constantly in contact with these activists who are trying to turn back this project. So let me just talk real quick about one of these. There's so many of these in the book that are interesting, but this one is particularly kind of haunting case study in the book. And this is about a particular human security project articulated in order to rescue the reputations of women in a particular working class community called Darul Ahmar in Cairo, and in order to also rescue the cultural and religious integrity of an area identified with some of the most sacred sites of Sunni Islam. This area called Fatmid Cairo by the urbanist redevelopers, as well as by these kind of moral rescue campaigns. Fatmid Cairo, or Islamic Cairo, is a set of neighborhoods in Cairo where Al-Azhar is based, which is kind of like the Sunni Vatican. It's kind of a center of Sunni jurisprudence, of moral and legal authority over Sunni Islam. And it's a site of many beautiful mosques and structures from dating back to the Fatimid period, to the Ottoman period, until late 19th century. So, beautiful neighborhood of amazing architecture, incredibly important in terms of Sunni religious moral legitimacy, but which had become a kind of low-end, highly densely populated slum of manufacturing and trade and kind of tourist hustling and, you know, kind of like the classical, popular, lower working class Cairo neighborhood. It was full of women in apartments making, doing piecework for Chinese garment producers. It was full of small metal working establishments that were fixing cars or motorcycles or making small little kind of rip-off appliances, copying, you know, can openers and things like that. Just small industries, small manufacturing, piece goods work, you know, kind of tourist hustling around these monuments, all kinds of activities, which for certain moral reformers was kind of a horrifying in form of impurity and social degradation, given that this is the most important hub of moral and legal legitimacy in the Sunni world.
So I was actually living in this neighborhood my first 2.5 years in Cairo, and I was working on these battles between Salafists, a kind of conservative, moral, charismatic movements who were attacking the local Sufi movements and the kind of women identified as a kind of brand of Sufi-oriented movements identified with czars, which are kind of a certain kind of very spiritualist practice of Sufism in which women were leaders. And so these particular practices were branded very much as deviant and perverse by these new moralizing Salafist leaders. And gradually, again, it's kind of a way that's seen parallel to Brazil, and since I was going back and forth, these Salafist groups began to ally themselves more with the vice police in trying to purge the neighborhood of these kinds of more spiritualist and unorthodox forms of Sufism, as well as these different kinds of low-end industrial practices and piece good manufacturing that kind of that soiled the religious and sacred landscape of these areas. So now I had already written up my study of how local social movements like the people of Deir al-Ahmar's True Egyptian People Movement, which was an attempt to produce a defense for the Sufi communities tied with a kind of workers' rights movements for the different manufacturing industries in the area. And it was trying to produce, assure the government would not close down their labor movement activism and these Sufi shrines, that the government would not ally itself with the Salafis. Because when they would have these movements and these meetings in Deir al-Ahmar, the government would often accuse them of being terrorists themselves. So they're trying to distinguish themselves as social movement actors from the Salafists allied with the vice police. So little did I know, but at that same time in the 1990s, there was another researcher also researching conflicts between the Salafis, the vice police, and the local populations, the Sufis and labor unions. And was trying to develop a model for how the state could intervene in a way that could morally redeem the dignity of the women in the neighborhood and also clean up the threats to the religious purity and legitimacy of these institutions by reorganizing the economic activities in the area. So that guy that was also working in the same neighborhood and doing his field work the same time I was there was Muhammad Atta, the guy that led the attacks on the World Trade Center in 2001. So I was the only one, it took me 4 years to do it, to finally get a copy of his master's thesis in which he laid out this agenda, this human security agenda for rescuing Islamic Cairo from this, both the impurity of modern industrial degradation and also the impurity of mixing, of women mixing in public spaces, of Sufism degrading the purity of Islamic doctrine in the area. And he has a very sophisticated master's thesis that he wrote in Germany, in Frankfurt, and after the 9/11 attacks, his advisor was so horrified that he stole the only copy of the thesis from the library and held it in his drawers and his desk at home. So I had to, for years, talk to his advisor until he finally allowed me to read it.
And it is fascinating, and it's fascinating. The reason why I bring it up is because, it allows us not just kind of to see these connections between new forms of violence and the idea of the rescue and purification of those morally vulnerable in these spaces of economic inequality and degradation, but it also allows us to kind of reboot our history of the war on terror and reconnect it to these histories of moral conflict in the context of the securitization of politics. Why did Muhammad Atta think that by combining, as he saw it, a specially approved set of families who were morally pure would oversee a police apparatus, kind of like a siege in Iran, was his idea, kind of moral police, which they already had in Bahar in this neighborhood. I know so many of my friends were hung out by their hands like that in jail for violating the moral police codes in Bahar. So he would have a set of families, Muhammad Atta had an idea of a set of families approved by the state, would run the moral police operations in the neighborhood. But it wasn't just about repression. He had a very sophisticated geometry, or geography of how the neighborhood would be reorganized. Not in some, it was a utopian kind of fundamentalist vision, but it was also very modern and pragmatic. He would have cul-de-sac spaces in which women would be able to continue to work in these piece good manufacturing industries, and would continue to be able to do subcontracted work for the Chinese. He still wanted those global economies to function. And then in the central corridors, those would be dedicated to men's activities, and men would be able to have contact with tourists coming to see the monuments. He still believed tourists should be coming to see Al-Azhar and the Islamic monuments, as well as pilgrims, of course, coming to pay their respects and to study, to learn Islamic jurisprudence. But it was going to be very gender segregated. It was going to be very morally controlled to make sure that classes didn't mix, that men and women didn't mix, and that Sufis were eliminated, and these women's Zahar traditions were eliminated, and that a proper set of moral principles would be installed. And one thing, of course, that jumped out at me at the introduction when he talks about how these spaces would be redesigned is, of course, if you have women in the cul-de-sacs and you have men in the middle of a more modern corridor, then he's very concerned that you don't have the men overlooking the cul-de-sacs and seeing the women in those spaces. So you have to make sure to knock down all the tall modern towers in those cul-de-sacs looking over the women. So, you know, this might be the origin of his obsession with knocking down modern towers. So in the book, I go into more detail about he then went on to Aleppo after this, Muhammad Atta, to do more field work on a similar project he had for purifying the space of Aleppo in Syria, which, you know, really is like a plan of operations for ISIS at that point, way in advance. But then he in Aleppo, he encountered populations that had been removed from Little Aleppo in the United States and brought back to Syria. So where is Little Aleppo in the United States? Why were they removed from the United States to be brought back to Syria? Let me know where Little Aleppo is. Huh?
New York?
Yes. Why was Little Aleppo removed?
That I don't know.
To build the World Trade Center.
Oh, really? Oh.
Mm-hmm. So there you go. So it all connects back. So, this is a whole suppressed history of a different way to think about the origin, not just of violence in an abstract sense, but of literally how these forms of violent response moralized, culturally essentialized, and then militarized emerged during this period in very particular locations, and even in this case, a very particular individual, obsessed with tall towers, angered at the displacement of Syrians from the lower Manhattan to build the World Trade Center, obsessed with deploying new kinds of urbanism that were going to separate gender in order to rescue women from being seen by tall towers, in order to develop a new moral code that was going to both industrialize but save the moral constitution of Islam. So here we have another way to think about, again, the way that morality, gender, and justice play out in a completely different set of histories that get us out of the focus on the global north, get us out of the focus on the kind of moral transformation of governments that we understand as part of the humanitarian revolution, and instead forefronts these global south actors, in this case Brazil and Egypt, in a way that allows us to rewrite the script of global change, but hopefully also allows us to see really interesting opportunities for true progress. That in each of these cases, Muhammad Atta was responding to these social movements in Dar al-Ahmar that were merging labor activists and Sufis. In Brazil, those police military lines are responding to victorious, amazing, creative social movements of feminist activists, anti-racist activists, and workers' activists. In Egypt, now the military dictatorship only exists because of their desperate response to the incredible success and the beauty of the vision and the potential of that revolution in 2011. So, that's why this term securitization is horrible. Word is important, because in each case we have a case of victory, of success, of a real kind of democratization, including gender justice, including a critique of these hypocritical forms of moralism, but then the rug got pulled out by reliance on kind of security response, reliance on some kind of partnering with military and police, rather than a fundamental critique of the role of security in our society. So thank you for letting me talk so long. I hope you have some questions.
Yeah, there's usually not context of this.
No, that's right. I know it's very late.
So if anyone has questions, yes. Of course you do.
Oops, sorry. Hi, my name is Luke. I'm from the Pecan Department. Sorry. You mentioned you used a lot of religious terminology throughout this lecture, including sinning. And I just was wondering, since most religious leaders are generally conservative, but they also have a large effect on the populace and also can have effect on the military, as we've seen in Indonesia and other revolutions.
Right.
What is their role in human security and revolutions that you've seen in these case studies specifically?
Right. So actors that forefront, religious agendas, either associated with kind of public morality or else an ethical transformation of civil society, right? There are plenty of progressive groups that very much forefront this transformation of public morality, this demand for a new ethics of governance that will face inequality, violence, gender injustice. So it's not the religious dimension itself that becomes a problem, it's when we then give a kind of moral redemption mission specifically to these kind of security interventions. And that redemption mission focuses on this kind of mix of a protection and rescue, and then which almost becomes a shell of incarceration, in which those that are most targeted by these moral crises, that are most deemed a problem of public morality, then become dependent upon the intervention and protection of coercive actors. So this is that dilemma, because often these movements, these feminist movements, these anti-police brutality movements, anti-racist movements, the same group of people we know very well that are now mobilized in the United States, right? There's a reason why these sets of movements cluster together, because in essence their first critique is of the militarization of the state or the securitization of the state. So if they then paradoxically decide the way they're going to in the end protect themselves and advance themselves is by calling upon a kind of morally redemptive security operation or a humanitarian intervention that's an armed intervention, they've fallen back in the trap. They've abandoned the core of their politics, which is the critique of the security state. And that's why I think that it's an important argument, but I didn't want to get too sucked into it, why I substitute the frame of securitization for neoliberalism, right? Because I think you can't, as I've seen that leftist activists in Brazil and Egypt and the United States often do, they say like, okay, yeah, police and militarization of society and both, you know, what happened at my school, USSB, where we had 10 students murdered by a moral missionary zealot that wanted to punish blonde girls who are hypersexual by murdering them, and we've had something happen today, which I don't know if had a specific sexual agenda, but probably did. You know, these kind of militarization of society and this codependence of solving one armed intervention with another armed intervention has become so deeply ingrained. And then paradoxically, when leftist activists come to the forefront to figure out, or progressive or civil rights or human rights activists come to the forefront to look behind the origin of that social violence, often they say, all right, well, let's set the problem of policing aside and find and look at the deeper problems of neoliberalism or of social inequality, but separate from that question of the role of security forces. So I'm saying that dilemma can never be set aside, that the dilemma of the militarization of society and the codependence of social actors upon security actors has to be the core problem of any social movement. You know, of course, you can argue against that, but in the end, it's been the mistake of these actors that I've been involved with, and both in my master's thesis was on prison privatization in New York City, right? And what would happen if that was not stopped back then in the 1990s and put into the priorities of anti-racist activists at the time, right? So, you know, I focus very much on these dilemmas as key. Yeah?
You mentioned at the outset there was, a couple of bright spots recently. Mm-hmm. Maybe you could touch on one or two of those.
It comes a little. I think it might be the fact that it's like midnight in California and I'm living on caffeine alone. I'm like very shaky and apocalyptic tonight. But again, the reason why in 2013 this book was propelled by this very clear agenda was because I saw the potential of the unraveling of this ideology of security and the production of a new, amazing generation of youth movements that could see through that and could produce a new vision for direct participation, for getting beyond the identity politics of this religion versus that religion and this social group versus that social group. And I still think that the intense violence of these security operations and their attempt to constantly morally justify themselves is because they realize that in the end these security operations are all based upon a very insecure agenda and that the actual movements for social transformation have a much more solid argument and a much more solid basis for mobilization. It's so by constantly trying to change the conversation back to one of moral crisis, in the end, I think these institutions reveal their insecurity. So quickly, without any warning, you can suddenly have massive, massive eruptions in Beirut, which has been happening for the last weeks. We know this has happened every year in Turkey, and the entire country erupts, despite the fact that the police are unbelievably repressive, that the military has a long tradition of pure fascism in that country, as well as a very complicated relationship to secularism, etc. We've had incredible eruptions in Turkey. So exciting. Last elections in Turkey. We had a more interesting political party than anywhere in Europe come to challenge the AK party. A country that had mix of Kurdish rights activists, peasants' rights activists, gay and lesbian rights activists, had a transsexual political parliamentary candidate come close to displacing the dominant party, right? Which is, of course, why Erdogan is bombing everything that moves, right? He's like, you know, producing a war on every front you can think of to try to distract the country from the fact that there a revolution happened 3 months ago in Turkey. An amazing revolution, transformed the whole vocabulary of politics. We've had the same thing happening across Southern Europe. Again, Lebanon, who we've been, you know, Lebanon is the example of the fragmentation of identity politics, or the fragmentation of sectarian politics. Suddenly we have them, people from all backgrounds, all classes, Sunni, Shia, Druze, Christian, coming together to talk about trash and corruption and sewage and power outages by the hundreds of thousands in the streets. And, you know, it's something that those of us who live in the region forever, we still can't predict when this is going to suddenly happen, but it constantly happens. And in a place like Baghdad, which is so incredibly terrifying just to move from one street to the other, to have mass movements of tens of thousands of people demanding civil reforms and demanding access to education and water and electricity, not battling each other over ideology. There is still a much more secure base for these kinds of social demands if, again, we can kind of deprogram that security response, right? Which is a fundamentalism that lies below every fundamentalism, is that insecure response to a security response, right? It's in the end, the mechanism that lies behind all these moral fundamentalisms. It's a security response. So I see that this whole process has been a moment of incredible hope. I mean, and the violence reflects the threat this new way of thinking poses to those forces. But they're not eternal forces. We're not talking about ancient traditions. We're talking about the things that were produced in the 70s and 80s by the restructuring of military police economies and, very importantly, by the production of this legitimizing ideology of humanitarian protection. They're new things, and there's no reason why they can't be critiqued and dismantled. They're not ancient traditions. We're not talking about ancient Islam or old Christian values. These are new structures. And I think that's why the revolts keep happening, because they're trying to stop something that is new and can be uprooted. So yeah, I think you just kind of come back soon. Mm-hmm.
You just really make me feel much better than what the three of you.
Yeah.
But I don't think I need this.
You need it for the recording. I was wondering if you could address really a very personal experience, which is the complete horror with which I look at very decent, very mostly left people who responded to the breakdown of law and order under the Brotherhood, which no amount of convincing will tell them is not directly only the Brotherhood's fault.
Yeah.
It's despite, you know, things like the gas prices shooting up, and the minute the military gets back in power, oh, the gas is fine. Well, why were they not before? This amazing gullibility on the part of people. Yes, crime was ridiculously up. Is that truly something that was not actually in control of the state apparatus? These sorts of things are things that are, I mean, at the age of 45, I'm still shocked that very decent, very intelligent, educated, progressive in general people are willing to buy into, because they've identified the enemy as being, in this case, a religious group.
Yeah.
But it doesn't really matter. It was still the group that won a mostly fair election.
Yeah. Did you spend some time in Egypt in the period?
Yeah.
The Egyptian.
Mutamasriya.
Yeah, no, I mean, I have to, again, I'm a contradictory player in all this. I mean, that's, I think, why I get emotional when I really put my cards on the table. because I very much followed the Tomorrow Movement, the rebellion against the Brotherhood, and many of my friends were part of that. They had been the same people that had battled in the streets and had their eyes shot out by the military the year before, so it's not that they were militarists. The Brotherhood, as you know, right, had since the Tahrir days, every 3 months, totally betrayed all the other social movements, including all their own youth movements within the Brotherhood. Every 3 months it had become smaller and smaller and smaller until it was a group of about 6 men. Right, yeah. So there was a lot of reasons why people, including, I mean, many of the other political parties are made up of former Brotherhood members that were part of, that had stayed with this kind of revolutionary coalition. So the idea at the time, which was kind of a proposal, I remember watching from my window as the tanks would roll past the foreign ministry on the Nile, and you know, we knew what was going to happen, right? But the idea was that we were in dialogue with Tunisia, right? It worked for a time in Tunisia, although of course Tunisia's become more of this horrible security state than ever now. Of course, the bargain never worked. But the idea was that a massive civil mobilization with maybe, no one wanted to admit it, but maybe a momentary intervention of the military would produce a national umbrella coalition government. That was the idea. Then it did happen in Tunisia for a time when every political party was included. And the experience of the military in the first months after Tahrir was that, you know, when the people were battling for Mahmoud in the streets, was the military was not sure of its role and could be kind of, you know, pushed this way and that way. I mean, again, I'm just trying to put us back, and even someone like myself who's spending all my time on like the dilemmas of bargaining for the military, I never make a hard turn that makes this whole, you know, that makes all military and police actors just into a demon. I always imagine that as true social groups that are embedded in processes. And, you see from my whole talk today that again, I've been one of these, I have that human security ideology deep in me that like, no, history tells us not to ever think about it. But again, you know, we were watching in the streets of Cairo, right, these gangs dragging women to mass graves again and again and again. The gender quality of this whole thing is just unbelievable, right? And Cairo, female Cairo, right, was never like that. Friends and I, women friends would go out at 4 in the morning all over the town, even everybody like that. Very, very recent. And then we knew it wasn't the Brotherhood's fault, but there was a need to have a national coalition government so that everybody, instead of being marginalized and frustrated, all the institutions, all the other social groups, all the other political parties felt like they weren't able to participate. So the idea was, okay, not that the military take over, but that a national coalition government would form. But of course, that was a total emergency security response. You can't dismiss an elected president and elected parliament for a security reason that never works out. It never works out. And it was, of course, a bargain again with the military. And the military this time was completely different. It was, Sisi is not an army general. He is the leader of the intelligence services. He's like the CIA chief. And this time it wasn't the nervous army, which really values a nice relationship with people. It was the intelligence services, bankrolled by $50 billion, and eventually became $500 billion of Saudi aid. So none of us anticipated what kind of bargain with the devil we were making between the security services, between the intelligence services, and $500 billion of Saudi money. No one expected that kind of adversary. But I should have known about people.
It fought agreement. It's what it fought arms, but it fought convincing of common people. That's what I'm
Well, that's this. That's what, you know, even my mind gets bent around this, right? This arming the people are one hand. If society is is mired in this kind of, this notion of this kind of sexual moral violence is what we were talking about constantly, not just the feminists, right? Everyone was thought that society was utterly collapsing and that rape was flowing in the streets. And so then the military can restore order. I mean, that this is, you know, this is Weimar Germany. This is, you know, the classic populism that frames this kind of ultimate societal collapse as a justification for ultimate absolutism. And that's, in the end, people still, you know, 90% or whatever, will stand up and defend the military. I mean, it's this authoritarian, very rigid version of human security militias, right? But, you know, again, I think it's already dissolving that kind of level of support. But yeah, it's very frustrating. And in Brazil, we also have movements in the street demanding military rule, right? These signs that say, I love Brazil, I'm a Brazilian. That sounds very neutral, but what it means is when it says I'm a Brazilian, it means I'm a Brazilian, not a member of a political party that controls the state. I want a pure Brazilian relationship with the state, which now means I want military rule. So these authoritarians come back to this document. So anyway, sorry. Thank you very, very much.